Welcome to the third in a series of open forums organized to bring members of the UAB community together to discuss the most important issues facing us today. We are very, very glad that you're here tonight. I'm Suzanne Austin, Senior Vice Provost and Senior International Officer at UAB. I am also a Latin American specialist with a faculty appointment in the School of Public Health. And I will be serving both as a moderator and as a participant in the conversation this evening. The executive order signed on Friday has created anxiety, confusion, and concern for many in our community. While there are many who disapprove of this action, there are also members of the UAB community and beyond who support it. Your presence at this event demonstrates your concern about these important issues, and we take very seriously our obligations as leaders at a great public research institution to provide all members of this community with a forum in which to share your thoughts with each other and with us. Throughout its almost 50-year history, UAB has provided a safe and respectful environment for the expression of differing opinions from all members of its community. This is a tradition of which everyone on this panel today is especially proud. The two previous forums that UAB has hosted since the November election have also focused on challenging issues, and in both cases, the discussion has been both civil and respectful. Indeed, one of the most important historical roles of universities has been to model civil discourse and collegial behavior for our society as a whole. This is something at which UAB excels. We want you to know that we have heard your concerns and that this will be just one of several events to address immigration issues. Our goals today are very specific and respond to the many messages that we have received in the last few days. Our goals today are to discuss UAB's position on the executive order that was issued last Friday, to explain the rationale for that position, to demonstrate our support for all of UAB's international students, faculty, and staff, and for our community as a whole, to listen to your concerns, and to make sure that future forums focus on these issues. Our plan is to take questions for an hour, knowing that this is just the beginning of this important conversation. A lot of thought has gone into this forum. As I noted, we take your concerns very seriously. Thus, we have chosen this panel very carefully. Each of the participants represent important constituencies and bring unique perspectives to bear on this conversation. So let me introduce our panelists to you. First, UAB President Ray Watts. The idea for today's forum was his, and he has been instrumental in helping to facilitate all of the arrangements that make this event possible. Our other panelists are Vice President for Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, Paulette Dilworth, Director of International Student and Scholar Services, Catherine Crow, Chief Human Relations Officer, Alicia Jones, and Vice President for Student Affairs, John Jones. We will be using the same format tonight that we have used during our two earlier events. Please write your questions on the note cards that are being handed around, then pass your questions to our two volunteers from the Office of Student Affairs, who will be collecting them and handing them to me. We may not have time to get to everyone's questions individually, so I will be looking for frequently asked questions and if necessary, combining them to ensure that all of your most important questions get posed. And again, this will not be the only conversation on this topic. And we will save all of the note cards and all of your questions to help us build future events. In addition to continued events in this series hosted by the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, the UAB Institute for Human Rights has already scheduled several events this semester that address this topic specifically. And of course, we request that you conduct yourself in a way that is civil and respectful of all those around you. So let's get started with the first questions. So the first question we will direct to President Watson. Just so you know, the plan is that I will direct particular questions to certain individuals up here, but everybody will be able to respond and add information to the different questions that we get. I'm trying to find a good general one that we can open everything up with. We want to start from the big picture here. Here's a good one. Let's start with this one. President Watts, will you be releasing a more supportive stance for international students in the next few days? In what actual concrete ways will UAB increase its support for international students?
Well, as I said in my statement yesterday, that UAB is a public, state-supported institution does not take a position on political or partisan issues. That being said, we have put in place and in action all of the resources of this institution to support those specifically affected by this executive order. We reached out over the weekend and we have worked with them to make sure that everybody is safe and secure and taken care of and all of their questions are answered. So we will always support every student, every faculty member, every employee at this institution. And we stand for diversity, for inclusion, for everybody being able to have an equal say, and for equal rights of each person on this campus and in this community. And we will always stand for that.
Thank you. Other panelists want to add something to that?
I would just add that the International House on the corner of 16th Street and 10th Avenue is always open, always has been open to all of our international community. And we welcome you on a drop-in or appointment basis anytime, and we can answer your specific questions specific to your situation and provide you with direction to other resources if we can't answer your question.
Let me make a follow-up comment. We are here tonight proactively because of you and because of us, because of our university community. And we wanted to make sure that everybody understood our positions clearly and everybody understood how to get their concerns addressed. We as individuals have a responsibility to express to our elected officials in Washington, our views. And we have 23,000 employees and 20,000 students. If 100 or 1,000 or 5,000 of our people reach out to our elected representatives in Washington, it will have an impact. It will have a big impact. And so we urge each of you to do that.
Thank you. Here's another question, and Vice President Dilworth, I'm going to direct this one to you first.
Sure.
Independent of partisanship, to what extent do you believe, if you remain neutral in situations of injustice, you have taken the side of the oppressor? How can you reconcile your opinion with the stance we have officially taken?
That's a great question, and I would just begin by saying that One of the things that comes to mind for me right away is the idea of inclusion. We talk a great deal about diversity and the fact that we are a diverse institution. But as an institution of higher education, I think that it's important for us to remain neutral on some issues, because that allows people to bring their different perspectives to bear on particular issues. And if we tend to take one side over the other, I think we do that at the expense of inclusion. So it's important to keep in mind that the opportunity to allow people to have their diverse perspectives and to have these conversations that are civil around these issues is really important. That's sort of the cornerstone of what higher education is.
Thank you. Other perspectives on this? So it's interesting. The questions are falling into two general groups. And I know that there are quite a number of folks here tonight who have very specific immigration-related questions, and we want to make sure that we, to the extent that we can right now, that we get those addressed. So I'm going to ask some of those. We also have another question, and I'm going to pose this one to Vice President Jones. Why were the international flags at the Student Center removed?
Certainly, if you think about the flags themselves, our goal is to identify a permanent way to display our flags. So without having that particular mechanism to secure our flags permanently, sometimes the weather caused the flags to tip over, and sometimes the lack of having something more permanent, something more formal, it's not a way to present the flags as well. So even though we would like to have the flags displayed more permanently, we know the temporary mechanism in which we're using is not the most ideal. So as we move forward, we'll be working with the campus community to identify a more formal and a more secure way to present the flags. And I think the flags deserve that. So as we move forward, and certainly we will invite anyone in the audience or within the campus community to dialogue with us and help us figure out the best way to present the flag.
Yep, and I think some of you probably know that we're very close to opening the new facilities on the second floor of Stern Library that will be the home of INTU UAB and the Office of International Student and Scholar Services. And so there will be all sorts of flags and maps and all kinds of symbols representing our population from around the world in that particular venue. But I think that we have many opportunities on this campus to display our international diversity and diversity in all the forms that we have on campus. Let me get to a couple of the specific questions that folks have about immigration status related issues, and I'll pose these to Catherine. So one of them is, I am a US citizen of Syrian descent, but I do have an American passport. Can I leave the United States and come back in?
Yes, at this time, there is no communication coming out from DHS or any federal agency indicating that U.S. citizens will be impeded in any way upon returning into the U.S. If you have a problem re-entering the U.S., you will have the lawsuit of the century if they stop you as a U.S. citizen. So, no, U.S. citizens have not been impacted on the re-entry ban, according to any official communication from the Department of Homeland Security.
Great. Here's another one. What is the procedure to convert the visa from a student visa to an H-1B visa?
In a nutshell, let's see. First of all, you need a employment offer. In a bachelor degree requiring position, and the employer must agree to pay you the prevailing wage for that position in the Birmingham market. Our office will help your department or sponsor determine that wage based on DOL statistics. And after a few days of postings and gathering support letters from your department or sponsor, our office can file an H-1B petition for you. We are exempt from the cap on H-1Bs as an institute of higher education, so we don't face those same limitations. But so that's specifically for a higher education H-1B.
Great, thank you. Another question for the panel. What specific resources are you using to support international students? So I'm going to start with the answer to that one, and then I'll turn it over to the panel. But as the senior international officer here at UAB, I take very seriously my responsibilities to provide resources to support international students and faculty and staff on this campus. I can tell you that in the last several years, UAB has committed significant new resources and is continuing to do so to implement best practices on this campus to support all of our international constituents. I mean, Catherine's office is hiring new staff to help with very specific immigration-related issues because we need to be able to respond quickly when people have questions and have issues. But in terms of the larger international student community, one of the reasons that we were so interested in partnering with INTU is that they have a partnership model that has allowed us to bring new, particularly but not exclusively, academically focused resources to the international population on this campus, whether it's undergraduate students, master's level students, PhD students, or postdocs. And one of the commitments that we're making as an institution is that all of the services, the tutoring services, the coaching services, and John can talk in a minute about a lot of the counseling and wellness services that he's going to provide in his area. I mean, we are making those available to our whole international student body. So if you're a PhD student and you need help with something, we're going to provide it. If you're a postdoc, I mean, we're looking at all of the different issues that have come to us from the international student and postdoc community and saying, how can we address these? What services do we need? The other thing that some of you might be interested in hearing is that we have a very active Center for Teaching and Learning on this campus where faculty members from across the institution, from the School of Medicine, College of Arts and Sciences, everything in between, where faculty members can come and get assistance with any aspect of teaching. And the center is very focused on helping teaching become more engaging and supporting students where they need to be supported. And we're very excited. I think we're close to hiring somebody. We're hiring a full-time person whose job it will be to develop a curriculum, a series of workshops for faculty members who teach international students to become better teachers of those students. So we're taking a very holistic approach to this, and I would say that that approach reflects the approach that we've taken with our student body as a whole. So over the last several years, we've made more services available in general, and we don't need to go into all of that now. But the question was about resources to support international students, and we take this very seriously. I'm looking out there. I know that there are a lot of international students here tonight. If there are things that you need, let us know. Please communicate with us. Communicate with me. Let Catherine know. You know, people who can get the word to us. I'm in constant contact with people, you know, in various areas of the campus. We want to know what you need, so please, please let us know. John, do you want to talk a little bit about some of the services in your area?
Sure, absolutely. If you go back roughly 2 years, under the leadership of Dr. Watts, a decision was made to bring back student affairs. And within student affairs, there was a void, and that it was something in terms of we were not serving our students, international students, domestic students, students in general, well. So part of bringing back the student affairs to ensure that we have the resources, be it human and financial, to serve our students better. And one of the things that we're doing within student affairs is ensuring that our students have the resources to be better academically and to remove the barriers that prevent them from excelling, be it inside the classroom or within the campus community. And one in particular is our counseling services. Certainly, we have invested significant resources to help us best provide to help us best serve our students. And certainly, that's one or another entity in which can help our international students as well. You know, I understand that our students in general, or perhaps international students, are scared. We understand. And I hope that our international students understand that we are here because we understand that, and we care. We want to make sure that you're being supported. We want to make sure that you're in a safe community, and we want to make sure that we're creating the services that you need to develop as an individual and to develop as a community. And certainly, if we're falling short of providing those resources, please, as Suzanne indicated, let her know, let me know, and we would do better.
Can I add something?
Please.
Dr. Watts mentioned that as a part of our UAB community, we have 23,000 plus faculty and staff. And we recognize that even amongst our faculty and staff, that there may also be concerns in addition to those of our students. So our Employee Assistance Counseling Center also provides support for faculty, staff, and their families, because we also recognize that, you know, UAB is a microcosm of the entire city. And so there are things that are happening within our community that affect our faculty and staff. And so there are resources that are available for our faculty and staff and their family members, as well as they're dealing with some of the anxiety and uncertainty that situations like this may also cause.
Thank you. Anybody else? Here's another one. Do you believe that your statement of neutrality is truly effective enough to reassure your international students? As a first-gen immigrant, I am not reassured. And I think that we understand that you're not reassured, and we understand your concerns, hence this event tonight and the subsequent events that are going to follow. So we do understand that. And I think that what you started to hear from people tonight is our commitment to you and to providing a safe environment, to making sure that you have the resources that you need. But we know that us just being up here is not going to provide all the reassurance that you need. But we are committed to working with you and to doing everything we can. Catherine monitors the situation very carefully. So please know that we don't expect you to walk away from this tonight with all of the answers, but we're committed to providing as many as we can.
And the depth and breadth of the great resources of this institution will be put to ensuring that you are safe, secure, and have every opportunity here.
So here's a question for Catherine. Have any students been affected by the travel ban? If so, what has UAB done to help them? What are some concrete ways that UAB has helped ensure a more inclusive environment for Muslim students? So Catherine, why don't you take the first part, and then maybe Paulette and John could address the second.
As far as the travel ban, our office has not received any reports of any UAB affiliates, that is students, faculty, or staff directly employed by or enrolled in UAB, who were outside the United States at the time that the restrictions went into effect, or who were turned away at the border. We do understand that there may be some spouses and dependents who are outside the country now, and naturally that affects the student and faculty member as well. We are in touch with those individuals. They are informed of the options and the situations, and they're making good decisions based on the best information they have and are aware of the risks. And like everyone, we don't have all the answers. Everything is in flux right now, but we're in touch with them, and they know that we're there for them and will provide all the resources they need to handle the situation when they're separated from their loved one. As far as what we're doing to help, like I said, we are providing resources, open doors over at the International House. We have information and best practices on travel generally up on our website, and we will continue to post as new information comes down. We're trying very hard to stay away from rumor mongering and really only transmit actual concrete information from reliable sources. So that's what we're doing.
Also, for me, it's pretty much been on a case-by-case basis, but as students and faculty members have reached out to me for with questions, especially inquiring about what should they do, I've made every effort to make sure that they get referred to the right unit or area in terms of trying to make sure that they get assistance. And I would encourage you, and that goes back to the last question that was raised, I know sometimes it can be difficult to come forward, but I practice an open door policy, and I would encourage you to see the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion as a space where you're welcome to come with your questions, whatever they are.
Thank you. So what about the second part of the question? John, do you want to talk about what we've been doing to ensure a more inclusive environment for our Muslim community?
Sure, absolutely. Let me say this, too. Our ability to respond or react to any issue is only as good as the information that we have. So if you know of someone that may be in need of assistance or support, please reach out to any of us, be it folks on the panel, folks within the faculty ranks, folks within the staff ranks, or other students who are more connected and involved as well. So if you see something, say something. Please do not sit idle and let a situation fester. So that's one piece. The second piece is, as you think about who we are as an institution, we're committed to serving students exceptionally well. And certainly resources are identified and dedicated to ensure that our students are successful, again, both inside the classroom and throughout the campus community. So, within student affairs, we have counseling services, health services, diversity programs, multicultural, student involvement, SAR, just to name a few. Again, these are professional staff members who are dedicated daily to ensure that our students are getting the resources that they need, as well as having those conversations and plugging them into the right locations to help resolve issues or concerns. Again, if there's more things that we're not doing, please share or communicate that with us as well.
Thank you. So another question. There are a couple that are sort of related, so I'm going to combine them. What is the process to vet and approve international students for admission? And the other part of this is, given that UAB is internationally focused, how will this ban affect recruitment? And first of all, to the admissions process, I mean, international students have been applying to UAB ever since it began as an institution, and we're very proud that over the last almost 50 years, we've had thousands of international students come through our doors. And in general, they go through the exact same process that anybody would go to who applies to UAB. The option that we've added in our partnership with INTO is that we are able to offer pathway programs, which are a combination of high-level academic English and coursework that actually counts toward a degree. So we've now added a second entryway, gateway into the university through that process. But in general, international students apply just like everybody else and are treated just like everybody else. As to what effect this will have on our international recruitment, it's early days. I think that all public and private institutions across the country right now are watching to see what happens. This is an ever-evolving situation. We are all very focused on our international populations, making sure that people have what they need, and time will tell. I think, you know, one of the reasons that events like tonight are so important is because as people, both inside and outside the institution, they're watching us to see whether or not we mean what we say. And while people might not always like the particular position that this institution has taken, what we do model as a public institution of higher education in the United States is respect for debate, respect for all opinions, and providing a safe environment for all of our campus community. And I think that as this drama plays out, people around the world are going to watch us as universities to see how we conduct ourselves, how we take care of our own. And my hope is that that will help reassure people. But again, it's early days, so we don't know exactly what the impact of this is going to be. A couple of other specific questions for Catherine. I'm a Kuwaiti PhD student. Can I travel to Cuba and come back to the US to see my children?
Our official advice during especially the next 90 days is to refrain from any discretionary travel outside the United States. That's a very conservative position, obviously, but it's what we're advising because the situation is changing so quickly. In your particular instance, I would advise against that. Just because we do not know, and I'm not clear if the children are in Cuba or the children are back here, but regardless, I would please come talk to me specifically about your situation, and we would be happy to provide a travel letter, which we provide to all international students and scholars who are traveling home or on visits internationally, that you can present on your way back into the United States. But at this point, our official position is to cancel non-emergency international travel.
So here's another one, Catherine. Can the administration declare legal permanent residence illegal?
The administration of the United States?
Or I'm not sure.
Either way, anybody's administration. Can they declare lawful permanent residence illegal?
Yes.
That is probably not the route they would take. Lawful permanent residence is a type of visa status, and the process they would take is probably to revoke the lawful permanent residence status. We, as I said, are following it hour to hour to see what ideas and policies are coming out of Washington, but I don't think they would take that route.
Okay. Thank you. So there are a number of questions here that all are asking about basically the same thing. And that is, will there be an explicit statement made by the administration that clearly states that UAB will not be releasing the immigration status of its faculty, staff, and students? So that one has come through in several iterations. Catherine, you want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure. I think that's a question in a lot of people's minds. There are several laws in place protecting private information, especially student records, which I'm sure John can talk about too. But we have no plans to release any information about the status of any individuals at UAB. Most of it would have to require a court order. And, you know, we would obviously comply with the law, but there are no plans to release any information about anyone's status here.
John, do you want to talk a little bit about student data
Sure.
in general?
You know, regardless if you're, you know, your place of origin, international student, domestic student, whatever the case would be, you're a student. That's a student record. So in order for us to release that, it must be a court order. And certainly, if you're aware of what's going on within the other institutions, they've even taken a step to identify the number of international students being impacted with the ban. Certainly, you have not seen that from UAB. We will not release any information whatsoever in terms of numbers or any student records.
Thank you. This is a slightly different take on a question that we talked about a minute ago, but I think it's really important, so let's talk about this again, and I'll ask this of John. What is UAB doing to fight Islamophobia? And then maybe, Paulette, you could talk about that as well. You want to start, John?
Certainly if you look with our staff as well as division within the student department, diversity program, multicultural students, and certainly if you look at their efforts, even though it's much more broader in terms of their commitment, engagement of providing a supportive, safe environment for academic pursuits, that is within the student population. And certainly, I will yield to Paulette in terms of what her department, her division doing within the campus community. So I am I go with Paulette, then I'm going to drill down in terms specifically with our students.
Yeah, as the Chief Diversity Officer, one of the things that I advocate is education. And so a lot of what we are planning to do has to do with the idea of providing opportunities for us to educate the community, particularly around these issues of Islam and the extent to which there's a lot of misinformation out there surrounding this particular group and the community. We do have some programs that we are planning looking ahead in terms of additional forums, and I encourage you to encourage others to participate in these experiences, because it's often interesting to learn as conversations evolve that people really don't know what they don't know. And so a lot of it is just really about, first of all, what are the facts, and how then do you educate yourself to have conversations around some of these issues, particularly the ones where you have less opportunity to engage with people?
Sure. So, from the university-wide effort, and certainly within the student population, our leader, Chris Jones, is working with students to develop programs, develop initiatives to advance the education as well as the information of all our students. And certainly, I think some of that hatred or some of that the ill will towards people, it comes from a lack of information, a lack of knowledge, and a lack of understanding. And certainly we are working to challenge, to push people to be more open, and for people to get outside their comfort zone and to learn something different, something new. And as that learning takes place, people evolve, become more mature, and certainly more accepting and understanding of all our students.
And I might add, one of the things that we really are interested in, help us address some of these issues. So if you have ideas for programming, speakers that you'd like to hear from, or people that you think would bring a level of expertise to bear on some of these issues, by all means, let us know who those people are and what the ideas are that you have in terms of future programming around these issues.
So this is an interesting question. Walk us through the actions that have taken place since the executive order was issued on Friday night until tonight. And I can tell you that there's been a lot of activity going on this campus since Friday, and I will let President Watts respond to that one.
Well, we were in communication throughout the weekend, and we made sure that we were reaching out to those that were affected, as well as we were conversing about how best to address the university community. The chancellor and the three presidents of our three institutions had a video conference Monday morning, and it was decided that each campus would be able to respond in their own way, but all three campuses agreed that, as is the tradition for all three campuses, that we would not take a political or partisan stance one way or the other, but we would make it very clear to all of our people that we will provide every resource to make sure every person is treated well and protected and safe and secure and as informed as possible. And we have stayed up to date with what are the evolving pieces of information, and we've made those available on a continual basis.
A question about the School of Medicine. Why doesn't the School of Medicine have a diversity staff right now? So I don't know, Paulette, if you want to talk about that. I mean, I think that there is, there's a diversity officer in the School of Medicine.
They do have Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs. Now, I did take one of the people
there you go.
Yeah. So hopefully that person's going to be replaced soon, but I think that there is a program there still. It's just that the person who was working in that particular office has come on board in my office. Brandon, why don't you stand up? Because I think a lot of people know who you are.
That person is right here.
Yes. But Dr. Wolf now works in the Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs, but the office itself did not disappear.
And there's a senior associate dean for diversity, Dr. Mona Fuad.
Right.
So this is also pertaining to the School of Medicine. What is the university's plan for the residents, fellows, and medical faculty that are affected by the executive order? Who can they talk to for help? And I think the answer is they can talk to Catherine at any time, and I'm sure that the Associate Dean for Diversity in the School of Medicine would also be a good resource. But I think for very specific immigration-related questions, I would be talking to Catherine. And then the last question in that series is, have any House staff been affected by the executive order? And I think the answer is no, because as of right now, we don't know anyone who's being directly affected. Another one. If you hold dual citizenship in the U.S. and one of the banned countries, can you travel to the country in question without fear of being refused re-entry?
It's unclear from the question if the dual citizenship is U.S. and another country or two other countries. There's lots of conflicting information out there about that right now. If you hold dual citizenship of two other countries, say Canada and Syria, there have been reports going both ways. If you try to travel on the Canadian passport, depending on the port of entry, they may question you about your dual citizenship with Syria. If you travel with your Syria passport, then definitely you will be refused entry. The ports of entry, the Customs and Border Protection agents at the ports of entry have been given wide discretion on a case-by-case basis to allow entry to individuals who are not a perceived threat to the United States. So my advice would be to present your non-listed country passport at the port of entry and then be prepared to be questioned, but on a case-by-case basis, they are allowing individuals in who are not perceived threats. And I know that's incredibly vague, but that is the actual statement.
This is a more general question. And by the way, thanks for all the questions. They're coming in fast and furious, and I'm trying to make sense of them as they come in and make sure that we hit all the main points here. What is UAB's stance on free speech, including hate speech on campus, by faculty, staff, and students? Any policies or procedures in place for people to report hate speech or harassment? Dr. Dilworth, would you like to take that one?
Well, of course, there is protected speech, and we do have policies in place with regard to the opportunity for people to report incidents of bias. It's on the Student Affairs website as well as on the Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs webpage as well. And you can do that anonymously, or if you actually want to do that in person, we're always open to that. But free speech is part of, I guess, the practice of the academic enterprise, and so it depends. Now, you can't run into this building and scream fire, because that does create a problem. But on the other hand, the exchange of ideas, whether they're competing ideas or ideas that people would consider to be, I guess, blatant in some level, still is open, and in some cases it's open for debate in terms of who gets to say what.
Well, one thing I will add is from a work environment standpoint, we want to make certain we have an open and supportive and safe environment for everyone to come in and be able to work and be successful. And so if there's ever any thoughts of from our faculty or our staff, particularly our staff, that there's a bad environment, you don't feel safe, you feel that people are making comments that create a bad environment for you to be able to succeed, then the process is to reach out to HR, and we will definitely work with you and work with the department to make sure that the environment is conducive to your success.
Thank you. So there are a number of really good questions here, and this is something we're keenly aware of, that have a common thread. And that is, why is there no representation from the Muslim or Arab community from affected groups on this panel? Similar vein, where are the students and refugees that are affected? Can they be on the panel? Great questions, and one of which we are keenly aware. And as I said in the beginning, our plan was tonight to come here and to address a couple of very specific issues, something very immediate that we were receiving lots of questions about. What is UAB's position? What's the rationale? What are you doing for the international community? But the plan is that there will be more events that will include all of these different groups, all of our constituents, both from the campus and outside the borders of the campus. So again, this is just part of an ongoing conversation. Again, I'm going to be taking all of these note cards so that as we plan these future events, we make sure that we address these things. But again, if there are other groups that you would like to be part of this ongoing conversation that we're going to facilitate, please let us know, and we will make sure to include everybody because we want to hear all voices in this.
At the first forum, the president of the Birmingham Islamic Society was on the panel, along with others with various different backgrounds and so forth, and that was on purpose so that everybody could represent their ideas. We chose to have this event tonight in a very short time window because we felt the need to communicate broadly with all of our university community sooner rather than later and answer these questions, make these resources known, and let everyone know where we stand, and that is equal rights for everyone and protection of everyone.
Great. So here's another interesting one. We have been addressing questions from international students, but what do Americans think? Do you realize that 99% of international students are not planning to go back to their countries? Are they bypassing immigration process, entering as students, and then competing against us for the few jobs available? And let me just say before I turn it over to my colleagues on the panel that I think I'm really glad that somebody posed this question, because I think very often we tend to think that everybody agrees with our own particular positions. And this is a good indication that not everybody who's here, and certainly not everybody in the UAB community, is opposed to the order, agrees with what everyone else has to say in the room. So I'm glad that somebody raised this question. I don't know that it's true that 99% of international students are not planning to go back to their countries. I know that a lot of people say things like that. I don't know that that is a fact. We can certainly talk about bypassing immigration process. I think that is virtually impossible to do these days. But I think that the concerns expressed on this card are important concerns for this community and for those of us who are gathered here tonight to be aware of and to be thinking about as we continue to go forward over the coming weeks and months with these conversations. So would anybody on the panel like to address that?
Well, we have developed our more robust exchange with other nations and with international students with the very mindset that we want to establish collaborations with nations around the world, and today is indeed a global society. We want our students who are from the U.S., who are from Alabama, to meet others from very different backgrounds so that they can understand together that they're much more alike than they are different, and to understand those differences and realize that they're more superficial than not, and that we all in the end strive for similar goals and want there to be a great global society. So we intend to increase those collaborations, and we have done that throughout our history. Many of the programs we have around the world that are working and studying are from collaboration. Someone came here, or some of our faculty or students or others went there. So this is about creating bonds and creating friendship across nations and creating collaboration and giving all of our students the best opportunities possible for a responsible global education.
If I can make a quick comment, one of the exciting things for me, and certainly I believe it's for all of us in this room, is that we are a diverse campus community with different thoughts, ideas, and opinions. And because of that, that makes UAB an incredible university. So that's something to embrace, and I just leave it at that.
Well, one other statement I wanted to make as relates to that question is from the recruitment standpoint. UAB is the largest employer, single-site employer in the state of Alabama. And whenever we have a vacant position for our faculty or staff, we recruit for the best person that we can come in to help further our mission. And we encourage to have active and affirmative recruitments, which means that everyone has an opportunity. So we don't create opportunities for anyone that's in one group or the other. We're looking for the best talent for our positions, and we want to create opportunities for everyone to be able to succeed in this environment.
Might I add one? Along with what Alicia just said, I think it's important too to keep in mind that for students going forward, once you leave UAB, a lot of you will be going to work for multinational corporations, and those corporations are looking for people who basically have had experiences beyond your comfort zone, beyond your reference group. So I think that the value that's added to you with the UAB degree, having the opportunity to have those experiences with your international peers, is important. And if it were me and I were in that position, I'd be looking for ways to take advantage of it.
Great. So we've only got a few minutes left, and I do want to make sure that we answer some of the questions posed by some of our international folks, just because I think there's a certain urgency to this. Here's one. I am a UAB physician. I work with a diverse group of healthcare providers caring for an equally diverse patient population. Recent events and social media have punctuated how polarized our community is. You have spoken about educational programs. Will there be any required diversity programs for faculty and staff?
Go ahead.
That's a great question. There are two things going on right now, I think, that you probably would help. We are right in the midst of developing the university strategic plan. That's an open process, and I would encourage all of you to take some time to go out on the comment section and go to some of the open forums where we're receiving feedback. Then the other has to do with the strategic diversity plan, which we're also developing what we're characterizing as strategic goals. And that's one of the areas that came up in our last Equity Leadership Council meeting, was the idea of providing varied curriculum opportunities for students to learn beyond what's required in their courses of study. So I think that's a great question, but the conversation is open.
And for our employees, there is an active diversity education process of onboarding and being a part of this community.
Great, so this is another important question. Does the executive order affect the issue of student visas or H-1B visas that are already being processed, Catherine?
Yes, as I understand it, and as has been communicated in various memos and updates from federal agencies, there are evidently some USCIS offices, field offices, that have halted processing even non-immigrant benefits that are pending here in the United States for individuals from those seven countries who are present in the United States. I'm keeping my eye on that. I expect more and clearer and better information. At this point, given that most of the executive order is focused on this 90-day period of review, we're of course hoping that after the 90 days, processing will resume for these individuals. Watch our Globetrotter newsletter, watch our Facebook page, email me individually if you have questions. We're keeping our eye on that, but yes, there does seem to be an impact on pending immigration benefits here in the U.S.
Thank you. And I know there are a number of other very specific immigration-related questions, and so we will be sure to take all of those back and make sure that they get addressed one way or another. Obviously, we don't have names on these cards, but if you've got a specific question that we haven't gotten to tonight, please make sure that you contact Catherine's office, and we will move to get those addressed as quickly as possible. There are so many good questions up here. We're not going to get to all of them. Let's see. I'd like to go back to a big picture question to sort of wrap this up. You continue to mention this idea of being inclusive to all opinions. To what extent can a university tolerate hate speech and ideas that marginalize international students and Muslims, or I would extend that to all people in this community, before being considered a participant in that marginalization? If a university upheld segregation in the 1960s because it was lawful or because people supported it, would it have been considered being inclusive of opinions? So I don't know.
I would offer this comment that not all speech is good speech and not all speech should be accepted or tolerated. If it crosses the line, I think we tend to know when that happens, that's the opportunity for you to engage with someone and let them know that these kind of activities are occurring, whether you're in your classroom or just in a social gathering. But unless it's brought to the attention of someone, I don't know that it can be addressed properly. So if that has been an experience that someone has had, I'd like to know more about it. And certainly it is something that we should be addressing as far as hate speech goes.
While we believe in free speech, we do not believe nor will tolerate hate speech.
In addition to that, within this last year, we developed a mechanism in which students can report that kind of information online. They can report anonymously, or they can identify a staff member. Certainly, our ability to respond to any of that regarding a student is only as good as the information we have. So if you're experiencing that, or if you know of something like that, please share.
And this particular question includes the idea referencing back to segregation in the 1960s. And I don't know, President Watts, if you want to talk a little bit about UAB's role in the city of Birmingham and in the civil rights movement during the 1960s.
Well, in our discussions over the last day or so, and sort of referencing that time, we are extremely proud that University Hospital was the hospital that anyone who was injured from any background was brought to and was cared for equally and very well. And at that time, Jefferson Tower had a public service and a private service. And John Kirkland, who was the most famous physician here, cardiovascular surgeon, said in those days in the 60s, the public service, which is where a good number of African Americans were, that will be my service, and I'll take responsibility for all of those patients. And you can imagine what that did and what that said without saying more to everyone else. So UAB was on the forefront of opposing segregation.
Thank you. So again, I have tons more questions here, and we will go through these and make sure that they get addressed in upcoming events. I've got one last one that I'm going to direct to somebody who isn't on the stage, our Chief Communications Officer. Is it appropriate or welcoming of diversity for UAB Hospital to sponsor the hate speech on radio station 101.1? The hosts on this station openly advocate for aggression against transgender people, number of other things that they apparently are saying. Does this reflect the mission of the university? Should UAB really pay people like this? Right. So whoever wrote this down, that's Ann Buckley, UAB's Chief Communications Officer, and we thank you for letting us know about that. I want to thank you very sincerely for being here tonight. This is very important for all of us. Again, just continuing the conversation, stay tuned. A couple of things that are coming up very soon, let me just mention these to you. As you know, UAB has a newly launched Institute of Human Rights. There is an event coming up on February 16th, Stand as One, Empowering Marginalized Voices in Birmingham. And then in March, there are two events of particular import here. On March 8th, the Global Refugee Crisis, Explanations and Implications, led by Dr. Tina Kempen-Reuter, who's the director of the Institute for Human Rights. And on March 22nd, the United States' last ambassador to Syria, Robert Ford, will be on campus, and there'll be more information coming out about that. So again, thank you all very much. Stay tuned. There's going to be a lot more going on, and we appreciate all of your wonderful questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.